Okay, and with that, we get to the final section of this series, where we look at skills and knowledge that, at this stage, I wouldn't call essential for every tokenomics expert to have, but certainly are handy accessories that will often enhance your ability to understand the problems you have to hand and how to tackle them thoroughly. This is not an exhaustive list. It just highlights a few areas that have caught my attention. So let's kick off by discussing game theory. Now, in case you're not already familiar with it, game theory is a mathematical discipline that models so-called strategic interactions. These are economic situations where there are outcomes of value to some agents, but where those outcomes don't just depend on what a given agent does by themselves, but on what the others do as well. In addition to that, the agents are able to reason about the actions that others are going to take in order to choose how they are going to behave. These situations are commonly found in games that we have created for our own entertainment. And so that's where the name game theory comes from. Now, a lot of what I'm going to say today about game theory in the context of tokenomics applies to other methods from microeconomics more generally. But it's game theory that has the brand recognition and sex appeal compared to other areas of microeconomics like mechanism design or social choice theory. Now, for something that was once a niche mathematical discipline, game theory is now actually talked about quite a bit in blockchain. Unfortunately, it is sometimes misappropriated to dress up opinions and low-level analysis as having some kind of intellectual weight. The worst example I can think of this kind of misuse is Olympus DAO's payoff matrix that it used prominently to market the supposedly sound fundamentals of its design. This project at its peak had a market cap exceeding $4 billion and had a peak daily volume of around $500 million. As you can see, a lot of people lost a lot of money. In order to explain just what the problem is with this representation, we need to cover some of the limitations and misunderstandings around game theory more generally. Now, I'm sharing my views on this topic as someone who was lucky enough to have studied game theory formally with a professor of some renown in the UK, Ken Bidmore, who used game theory to design auctions of 3G bandwidths for the UK government that raised £22 billion. He was awarded a high honor by the Queen for this work. I was very fond of this topic as a student and would take extra time to hang out in PhD seminars where we'd discuss game theoretic models that underpin the evolution of trust and cooperative behavior in humans and animals, a strong personal interest of Kent's. Now, obviously, I don't have the same standing as a true professional game theorist who applies these methods in their work day in, day out, but the education I've received is enough to support the fairly general observations that I want to share today concerning the opportunities and shortcomings of game theory in tokenomic modeling and misunderstandings that I've seen around the topic. So, first things first, game theory is relevant to tokenomics. That's a resounding yes. I'm not debating that at all. But in the vast majority of situations that are going to be of interest, game theory is unlikely to be able to offer a rich enough description of the economic system to give us a final word on how it behaves or how we can apply design to achieve some desired outcome. The position I'm going to build up to is that in tokenomics, game theory, or even just parts of it, are best regarded as one more tool in the box, so to speak. To show you why, let's look at the way that basic game theory is typically introduced to students with a simple 2x2 payoff matrix. First thing to understand is that this is an abstract representation of some economic situation, which singles out key elements for our analysis. We are using a 2x2 matrix because we are depicting a situation in which there are two agents or players, and each of whom has two actions that they can take. The two rows you can see represent the two possible actions that player one can take, and the two columns represent the two possible actions that player two can take. Together, they make a grid that represents all the possible combinations of actions which can occur. So here in the green box shown, player one takes action one and player two takes action two. Inside these quadrants in the rounded parentheses, we have a pair of real numbers that describe the economic payoffs to each player in that specific outcome. The first number represents the payoffs to player one, and the second number represents the payoffs to player two. The next concept that game theory students are introduced to is a standard model of economic rationality, which determines how economic agents choose the actions they will take. We're taught that each agent acts to maximize their own gains, that means get the highest number that they can, and that they can anticipate how the other player is going to act, including taking into account that other player's anticipation of what the first player is thinking, okay? In the simplest games, like the one showing now, To find the Nash equilibrium, the choice that the player makes, anticipating how the other player is going to play, all you have to do is to circle the biggest numbers to come to a view about what's going to happen. Let's see how this works here. Suppose we look at player one, thinking about what action to take if player two were going to play action one. We see that action two is better, so let's circle that number. And then if we look at player two playing action two, the same thing occurs. The second action is dominant, so we circle that one as well. If we now switch to player two's perspective, imagining what to do if player one plays either of their actions, the situation's exactly the same. You see that both numbers are circled in the lower right quadrant here. So the analysis tells us that we always expect players to choose action two, and that's the outcome that always occurs. It may have required a couple of new ideas to get you into this new way of thinking, but actually no sophisticated maths was needed to solve this problem. It's easy to explain on YouTube, and some people unfortunately come away thinking that that's all there is to game theory. Well, spoiler alert, it isn't. This representation makes a lot of strong and restrictive assumptions about the situation that we're depicting. We're assuming that there are just two players, they can only take two actions, the actions are played at the same time, they only play this game once, the economic payoffs can be measured and represented with the numbers shown, they each have knowledge about each other's payoffs, they reason about their situation in that specific mathematical way which we described earlier, and that they fully believe that the other person will reason and act in the same way too. So now that we have some understanding of the assumptions this kind of representation entails, let's bring back the Olympus DAO payoff matrix. The only general difference to our example here is that this is a 3x3 matrix. And this is so because we now have three possible actions which we can take with Olympus DAO's token Ohm. To give you a quick explanation of what's going on, we can either stake Ohm tokens for an astronomical yield denominated in Ohm. We can bond, which is to buy Ohm using another digital asset at a discount to current market prices set by Olympus DAO itself, provided that when you buy, you're prepared to wait a little time to receive that Ohm. Or we can just sell the Ohm. Now, the rough logic that's used to generate the payoffs in this matrix is that staking raises the price and therefore the payoffs to Ohm holders, while selling lowers prices and lowers payoffs. The impact of that logic is clearest to see in these two extremes here, where nobody's sold and everybody's doing great. And in this case here, where everybody's sold and they feel awful for it. Now, given what we've just covered, it should be clear that trying to fit the value proposal of these actions into this highly restricted abstraction is grossly misleading. The only detail on which this payoff matrix may have made an acceptable simplification is concerning the three actions available to its agents. On everything else, it fails. We have more than two players. Actions are not necessarily simultaneous. This game is playable more than once by the same players. We can't represent their payoffs with these cute, tidy numbers. Players don't know what the other player's payoffs are. Players don't necessarily reason in a mathematical way, and players don't know how others are going to behave. Now, technically, Olympus DAO had covered their rear ends by saying that the model was dangerously oversimplified, but they still went ahead releasing it and putting it all over their marketing. As a result, there was no shortage of commentators posing as sophisticated analysts, parroting this exact diagram and Olympus DAO's explanatory copy, except for that dangerously oversimplified part. Now, I don't want to dwell about Olympus DAO's intentions here, so let's just take them out of the picture. We still have a fundamental problem, which is that we have a mismatch between the reality that we're interested in and the ability of a chosen model to capture the relevant and important aspects of it. And because we have a bad model, we then make bad choices. This kind of problem is known as model risk, and I've referenced the issue a few times in this series, where we confuse the ability to create a formal or complex model with the ability to create a good one. Game theory is no exception to this risk. Now, game theory is much, much more extensively developed than what we've seen in those very simple games we just looked at. It's full of extensions that allow us to represent more complex situations and relax lots of the assumptions in that earlier list. But nevertheless, this model risk remains as to whether your game theoretic representation is adequate to mirror the key facts of concern in your economic system. And of course, that's fine so long as you have some awareness of those limitations. We come back to that saying, all models are wrong, but some are useful. Well, to assess the usefulness of game theory as a modeling framework, I think it's helpful to see that we can unbundle it into two sets of features. The first set equips us to describe an economic system and identify its key parts, the players, their actions, their information, and so on. The second set of features allow us to take that description and come to a view about how players are going to behave and how the system is going to evolve. Personally, I see game theory being most broadly useful in virtue of this first set of descriptive capabilities here. The game-theoretic approach pushes us to make this thorough and systematic sweep to identify relevant parts in our system, the players, actions, beliefs, and so on, as exhaustively as possible. However, as we saw in the case of Olympus DAO, I think we start running into trouble when we try to quantify payoffs. These are certain to be highly difficult to define properly. When it comes to the second set of capabilities, using game-theoretic techniques to predict how the system will behave using a model of agent rationality, I'm more skeptical. I think it definitely has value providing some rough sense-checking and allowing us to catch major flaws or unwanted consequences that initially went unnoticed. But even if we're satisfied that we have adequately described or specified our system, we're still challenged by the fact that our ability to model human decision-making and rationality is variable and highly context-dependent. The rationality models used in standard economics and game theory have been proven false in various experimental situations time and time again. It isn't that they never work, but many times they don't. Now, there are sub-branches of game theory like behavioral game theory and experimental game theory, which try to engage directly with these issues, but we're really niching down at that point. In terms of the professional talent available to work on these problems, I suspect it will be more common that we end up using machine learning to identify and segment the way that different users behave using real test data and use that to create better forecasting and simulation models. Right, so that gives you my own two cents on the relevance of game theory to tokenomic modeling and analysis. Key takeaways are that there's probably more to game theory than you think, and you should be wary when you see it being used to explain a complex situation. That this methodology is still really susceptible to modeling risk. It is probably most useful as a descriptive framework rather than a framework for prediction or optimization. And that these limitations help us to understand why game theory is generally going to be more of a nice to have than an essential skill for tokenomics experts.